Purnamidaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Brahman, the Absolute, is complete. Because he is complete, all emanations from him, such as the phenomenal world and living beings, are also complete. Beingness produced by the complete is also complete in itself. And because he is complete, although so many complete beings emanate from him, he remains the undiminished complete balance. So what are we doing here? Let me explain. Within every human being exists a source of energy, consciousness, intelligence, love, and enlightenment, and an inexhaustible divine well. We can draw nourishment from it without limit. This is God. This is Brahman. This is the Absolute, or Nirvana, or whatever you want to call it, Tao, or whatever. It doesn't make any difference what you call it, as long as you recognize it as the source. As long as you see that complete realization of this source is the complete solution to all problems. The difficulty that we have is that we don't have complete realization. We have some incomplete realization masquerading as complete. And because of that, our problems persist, even though we make so many efforts to overcome them. So when you feel lonely, separated, or incomplete, it's not because the well has dried up. It's not because God has forsaken you. It's not because Brahman has gone on vacation. It's that you have forgotten how to reach it. You have forgotten yoga, how to connect with the source, how to link your consciousness with the divine. And because of that, you're suffering. So to solve the problems of life and attain liberation, which means complete freedom from suffering, you need to rediscover and reclaim the tools and methods needed to reach the nourishing source. In other words, yoga is not another religion. In fact, it's not a religion at all in its pure form. Of course, there are many impure, incomplete forms of yoga, and that has caused so many more problems because they're masquerading as the truth when they're incomplete and actually distorted forms. So we're going to discuss that fully here. Then your wisdom and strength will be as timeless and inexhaustible as the well that nourishes them. We are tiny reflections of the complete whole. It's said in the Bible, man is made in the image of God. Well, what does that mean? Well, we're going to discuss this fully in the series, but just to put it in a nutshell, it means that each of us has the same basic structure, the same nature, the same spiritual essence as God, only in tiny quantity. That's the only difference. Qualitatively, we are the same. So then why are we suffering? Because we have forgotten how to connect the tiny drop with the ocean. Now, actually, the drop never leaves the ocean. It can. If you ask a fish, what is the ocean? Have you ever left the ocean? He doesn't know. He's not even aware there is an ocean because he lives in it all the time. Similarly, all of us live in Brahman, In fact, we are nothing but Brahman, just like the drop in the ocean. But because we have forgotten this, we become distracted by all this external stuff. Our body, our mind, all the material engagements and all these different functions that we have to perform in order to be in the material world and so on. So this Devānanda-Samādhi Yoga is not another religion, but a framework for a complete purnam, spiritual practice that brings the complete purnam, human being, all seven chakras, every area of life, to the highest energy state, samadhi, complete enlightenment, complete realization of the complete, realization of Brahman, which is the solution to all problems. And we want you to have this solution so that you don't have to suffer anymore. Okay? Please accept it. So it's interesting that before we even start really teaching anything, just introducing the name, Devananda Samadhi Yoga, we're already getting questions. Of course, they're kind of critical questions from people that we knew in the past and that are familiar with our history. So in order to answer this question, I'm going to have to give a little background for the new people. The question is, you were a guru before, and it ended in disaster. So why are you trying again? Well, you need to understand what actually happened and how it wasn't exactly a disaster. I was introduced to my first spiritual master, Srila Prabhupada, by my music teacher, Ali Akbar Khan, in 1967. And I hung around the outskirts of his movement until 1971, and I became a disciple. So I was initiated in 1971. Then I went to India for the first time in 1975, many times thereafter, living in the temples of the Hare Krishna movement and teaching Krishna consciousness, which was Prabhupada's teaching. I traveled all over the world. I lived and served in ISKCON temples actually until about 1988. After that, I broke with the organization. And I don't need to go into all the details of why, but it just wasn't satisfying. It wasn't meeting my needs. I had to look further. So even though I spent such a long time in ISKCON movement and studying Krishna consciousness, my present understanding is very different. My present understanding is that Krishna consciousness is a synthetic religion. In other words, it was concocted. It was invented. It was developed. It's not original. It's not timeless. It begins at a certain point in time. And therefore, it will also end. So let me explain. Krishna consciousness in its present form was developed and popularized by Rupa and Sanatana Goswamis, disciples of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, about 500 years ago in Bengal. Now try to understand, Rupa and Sanatana had been the prime ministers and finance minister, respectively, of Nawab Hussein Shah, the Mohammedan king of Bengal. And when they retired, they took with them something like 20 boatfuls of gold. So these were not ordinary men. They were great statesmen, great politicians, great scholars, and deeply self-realized people. Nevertheless, they were in a political situation and they felt they had to do something to affect that situation for the well-being and benefit of the people of India. And so they put together this teaching, which we now know as Krishna consciousness. Krishna, however, is not a very old deity or teaching as Indian culture goes. He was first introduced in the Mahabharata, a work attributed to Vyasadeva, but according to the best scholarship, it's only about 1,250 years old. That's based on the Sanskrit style and the copies and manuscripts that we have, the history of it as far as we know, and so on. Now, Krishna is portrayed as ending, or actually destroying, the Vedic Empire, and beginning the Kali Yuga by a war, by creating a situation where two branches of the same royal family had to fight one another. And so the Mahabharata is the story of that. However, if we look at what was going on in the world at the time Mahabharata was introduced, we see that it coincides roughly with the Buddhist Holocaust. In other words, after Buddha appeared in India, his teaching became very popular to the point where the Brahmins were threatened by it, and they felt they had to do something to retaliate. What they wanted to do was get rid of Buddhism entirely, to kill it, to drive it out of India. Now, it's one of the likely reasons that Mahabharata was composed, was to justify this religious war, this sectarian conflict, the slaughter of tens of millions of innocent Buddhists. Because up until that point, that concept had not existed in Vedic culture. The concept of the original Vedic culture given in Upanishads was the whole world is one big family. And so we don't kill our family members. And in fact, the Vedic Empire, or the Vedic culture, I should say, the empire was a myth. But the culture never started any wars, except maybe among themselves, just to delineate political boundaries and kingdoms and stuff like that. But the Vedic Empire, or the Vedic civilization, was very peaceful up until that point. But after Mahabharata was introduced, then came the Buddhist Holocaust, which is conveniently omitted from the Hindu, quote-unquote, teachings, where all these Buddhists were killed, Buddhism was driven out of India, which was a very unfortunate, terrible thing to happen. So I could go deeper into that, but I'm not going to right now. So Krishna's qualities and character, especially his pastimes with the gopis of Vrindavan, were further developed by a later work called the Bhagavat Purana, or Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam gives the history of Krishna's early life, whereas Mahabharata only talks about his life as a king after leaving Vrindavan. And it only alludes indirectly to those pastimes, whereas Bhagavatam describes them in detail. Now, why was Krishna introduced? Why was there a need to create a new deity? I mean, there may have been an actual historical person named Krishna, but certainly he was not the supreme personality of Godhead. He was probably just another Vedic king. But the necessity to introduce Krishna came from the need to consolidate all rasas, all forms of worship in one deity. Why? To answer the challenge of monotheism. Monotheism was introduced into India by Islam and then further reinforced by the Christian conquest and empire of India run by the British. And also, of course, to get rid of the Buddhists. So the necessity to open the Sringara Rasa, the erotic pastimes of God, to the public, came from the success of Islam. Because in Islam, if you're a believer, when you go to heaven, if you're in good standing with Allah, you get, I don't know, what is it, 125 virgins or something like this? Anyway, that was very strong preaching in India at that time. So something had to be invented, developed to counteract it. And that was Krishna's pastimes with the gopis. Previous to that, Krishna's pastimes and other gods' pastimes with their consorts were confidential, private. They were never discussed, never taught in any scripture. So this is the first time that those pastimes were made explicit and open to the public. So Krishna was introduced to accomplish these purposes as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Svayam Bhagavan. In other words, Svayam means the sum total, total of all the gods. And his pastimes, his conjugal pastimes with the queens of Dwarka and the gopis of Vrindavan. So Lord Chaitanya, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and the Goswamis broadly popularized this movement through the Hare Krishna mantra, because it's very easy to remember, very easy to chant. Although it's really strange, almost everybody I know who is not actually initiated in that movement gets it wrong. Huh? They're like, Hare Ram, Hare Krishna. No. Or anybody. It's a simple mantra. It's easy to know, easy to remember. So after my 25 years or so as a devotee of Krishna, I was more or less satisfied. I mean, we'll get into this later on in the fifth section on the fifth chakra, the worship of God or development of love, bhakti, for God, that basically all deities are concocted. They're basically all imagination, and it doesn't matter. It works anyway. That's because everything is coming from Brahman. And we'll get into this in detail. So I was thinking that whole time that I'm a devotee of Krishna and that my higher self or my spiritual identity is as a devotee of Krishna in Vrindavan. But when I actually developed this higher stage of bhakti, spontaneous love, I found that my actual object of love is Narasingha, Nrsingadev, the half-man, half-lion form. So later on in 2005, I founded a community and a teaching called the Esoteric Teaching based on my realizations. And I established ashrams in several places around the world, Mexico, Chile, and several here in India. So I thought at that time that I could do a better job of presenting Krishna consciousness than the ISKCON organization, because they had some really serious problems in that organization, which is why I left. But I wasn't aware at the time, although I came to understand this later, that all hierarchical religious and other hierarchical organizations incentivize sociopathy. They actually reward sociopathic behavior of the individual well-being being identified with the organization's well-being. In other words, like the CEOs who get huge bonuses, even though their companies are going bankrupt, because they're making money for the stockholders or other investors. So this is going on in not only religious, but every kind of organization. And any kind of organization that you found, even though you may try to make it as egalitarian and fair and good as you can, is still going to have the same problems. So despite my best efforts, the organization I founded also displayed these same problems, and I was obliged to resign. It's not that I resigned because of the scandal. I resigned, and then the students manufactured a scandal, because even though I was quite satisfied with my realization of Sringara Rasa in relation to Lord Nrsingha, nevertheless, actually beginning as early as 1984, I had several experiences, spontaneous experiences of realization of Brahman. Now, according to Krishna conscious philosophy, this is a lower stage. So how is it, after developing a very high stage of bhakti practice, I started getting visions and realizations in meditation of the Brahman? So even I doubted that these experiences were authentic, but this was reinforced when I did a book on Vedanta Sutra. Because even though in the Krishna movement, Vedanta is interpreted theistically, it's based on the Upanishads. And once you start looking into the Upanishads, you'll find there are serious disagreements between them and the modern theistic Krishna movement. I also got a competent translation of Rupa Goswami's Bhakti-rasamrta-sindhu. Now, Prabhupada issued a translation called Nectar of Devotion of this same work, but the editing was botched so badly that it's basically unreadable. And if you try to analyze it ontologically, as I did, you find all kinds of internal contradictions in the terminology and logic and so on. It's useless. If you read it, it will only make you confused. So fortunately, I got a good translation by Bhanu Swami. And from that, I was able to understand that the rasa tattva and the level of spontaneous bhakti, and that it actually does not preclude Brahman realization at all. So all these understandings and experiences led me to question very seriously what I had been taught in Krishna consciousness. So I resigned from the role of guru in the organization, and I dissolved the organization, gave everybody all their money back. This is something they won't tell you, but I did. I kept all my promises and obligations. And nevertheless, my students cut me off, refused to communicate with me, and started a series of vicious lies about my activities and so on. Now, I had started, or actually I had been exploring Tantra for many years. My mother was a Tantrika. I mean, she was a priestess of Karesa. And we'll talk about this later in section one. But I had even taught Tantra. I studied Tantra in India for several years with authentic Tantrikas. So I really knew what I was doing. Several of my students wanted to learn Tantra. They asked me, and so I taught them, or at least I demonstrated the techniques for them. And some photos of these techniques got stolen, and the student who stole them tried to use them to blackmail me, to give him more money than he was due. And when that didn't work, he outed me in public and turned it into a big scandal. So if you receive any of these pictures, let me know, because now this is called revenge porn, and it's a felony. And if this conspiracy to smear my character continues, I'm going to have to take legal action against them. So please let me know, and we can add it to the mountain of evidence we've already collected. But anyway, I walked away from that organization, spent a year or so traveling around Europe, and then I went to Sri Lanka. I went to Thailand first, but I didn't make any connection. In Sri Lanka, I found a nice monastery. I started studying Buddha's teaching and meditation. So I spent several years in Sri Lanka as a Buddhist monk, living in a stone cottage way up in the mountains and doing meditation many hours a day. And so I realized the first path through fourth path realizations. Now, of course, the Buddhists don't accept this because I'm not a senior monk, huh? But I am a senior monk. I've been a monk since 1971, just not a Buddhist monk. So anyway, I got all the realizations and I was very satisfied, but I still wasn't feeling complete. So I left Sri Lanka, I came back to India, and I spent about 6 months meditating on what was missing. And gradually, slowly, slowly, I came back to the Vedas. But now I saw the Vedas in a new light because of my realizations. I was enlightened, but I still was not fully enlightened, or at least I wasn't fully satisfied. What was wrong? I had to refine my practice even more. Of course, that actually never ends. But I had to gain a knowledge of the multidimensional nature of consciousness and meditation. So from this study came this Devānanda-Samādhi Yoga, because I had a realization of orgasm, ecstasy, in all seven chakras. First one at a time, and then finally all at once, about 2 months ago. I had this experience, it was a spontaneous experience, but now I found that I can have it whenever I want. So I'm feeling that this is a tremendous breakthrough. It's something I had theorized for many years, but then it actually happened, and it seems to be stable and repeatable. So as long as I keep up my practice, I think this is something I want to share with people. This is something I want to benefit people with. So the framework of this Samadhi Yoga system is based on the seven chakras, that all seven chakras are capable of ecstasy, and it can be simultaneous too. So this is unprecedented, this is unknown. It's perhaps hinted at in some obscure passages in the scriptures, but I actually experienced it. So this is what I want to share with you. So compared to this, all other teachings are very narrow, one-dimensional. Like the Hatha yogis are only doing asanas, right? And the Bhakti yogis are only doing bhakti, love of God. Or maybe they just get stuck in ritual. They don't even get to the love part. And the jnanis, the monists, and the Buddhists, the shunyata people, emptiness, they're only doing meditation. And they're thinking, that's all there is. There ain't no more. And I can reach enlightenment only through this process. But it doesn't work. They're not becoming enlightened. So the problem is, the people who are following a one-dimensional practice are not attaining enlightenment. I mean, they may be making some spiritual advancement. I'm not going to say they're not. But they're not developing the symptoms of the path realizations, or they're not developing any of the higher realizations like Brahman realization, Paramatma realization, or Bhagavan realization. So, what's wrong? Well, I had to see that the higher formless aspect of God, the Nirguna Brahman, as superior to the lower aspect of God, Saguna Brahman, God with form, such as Krishna or even Narasimha, my chosen deity. Now, this realization transformed my whole outlook, my views, my values, and everything. And I started to see that what I had formerly taught was not the truth, and it was actually harmful to people. Why? Because the Supreme, the God, you know, the one and only, cannot be in form simply because form is temporary. emptiness is the only thing that can be eternal. Why? Because it never changes. It never can change. Emptiness is actually the root or the origin of all form. So if this is coming from my experience, this isn't, I mean, you can read it in books too, but for me, it was an experience that when I meditated on emptiness, then something happened. The Brahman manifested spontaneously. The endless cosmic light, the infinite source of energy. This is it. Emptiness. Because why? Anything that has form, any kind of energy, any kind of manifestation whatsoever, has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And God is timeless, eternal, uncreated, undestroyable, indestructible. So he cannot have form. That's all right. God doesn't have to have form, because he can manifest all kinds of forms for specific purposes. And this is exactly what he does. He manifests many different kinds of life, many different kinds of being, just like the Upanishad says. From the complete come innumerable complete living beings. And even though so many complete beings emanate from him, he remains undiminished. The complete balance. That's only possible if he is emptiness, if he is nothingness. See, people don't understand because they don't study ontology. But this is the only possible conclusion. And it's also borne out by experience. So it's a deep truth. It's not easy to understand because people, especially in the West, are trained in positivism. That everything is a manifestation. Everything has being. But the source of everything that has being has to be beyond being and non-being. Otherwise, it can't be eternal. That's only emptiness. Once I realized this, I was like, oh, of course. So the Supreme must be formless and void. As soon as anything comes into form or being, it is subject to time and non-being or death. So since the Supreme is described as eternal and deathless, it can only be emptiness. Now, this is confirmed in meditation. As soon as you enter into emptiness, the Brahma Jyoti, the light of Brahman, spontaneously appears. So the Brahma Jyoti is the source of all other creations, and this is how Brahman emanates everything that exists, yet remains the supreme balance. So the teachings of Krishna consciousness and every other religion contradict this basic truth. So that's why I have to teach again, to benefit people, to bring the actual truth. Now, I should also point out at this point that hardcore monism is also wrong. Teachings of Shankara that say, you are God. No, come on. Individuality is also eternal. You can realize God with form. You can realize God without form. That doesn't mean you become God, either with or without form. You can enter into the pastimes of God with form, as a companion, as a lover, or you can enter into the presence of God without form. But that doesn't mean you merge. The philosophy of all religions is flawed. It's wrong because it's extreme. It's either duality, hardcore duality, or hardcore oneness, monism or dualism. But as the Buddha said, the truth is never in the extreme. So I follow the middle way. And the middle way is misunderstood to be a compromise, but it's not. The middle way is actually a whole new dimension. That's why the Buddha's teaching is so widely misunderstood, especially by Buddhists, because they don't get it. But the Upanishads do. The Upanishads and the original Vedas and even Vedanta is very, very good, very true. So now I feel satisfied. Now I feel like I really got it after all these years. And I feel so fortunate. I feel so lucky. Every night I go to bed, I close my eyes and I see that beautiful light just flooding all of space. And I feel so fortunate. I feel like I have to teach. I have to share this with others. It's my duty. And if I don't accept this duty, then I'll be incurring offenses. And I don't want to get on God's bad side. It's not recommended. So, we're going to discuss in great detail why and wherefore, how this is all going to work. But I'm not going to create another organization, because as I said earlier, organizations automatically create sociopathic behavior. They reward it. And they reward it by forcing the individual to choose for the benefit of the organization rather than the benefit of the human being, the individual. So we don't want that. We want the highest benefit for the individual. So we will not form an organization. This will be a one-to-one teaching. You will look at the videos, you'll contact me, you'll become a subscriber, you'll get on the Skype, and we'll have video conferences. After some time, you'll come here and take initiation. I'll give you the initiation, the techniques, the mantras, everything you need to duplicate my realizations. But you will never meet your other students. You won't even know who they are, your fellow students, because it's going to be person to person, one to one, you and me. So I don't think this falls under the definition of guru, because it's pretty much assumed that a guru is going to form an organization to condition people's minds in some teaching. So although I have some methods, they're personalized, they're individualized. I will not give the same teaching to two different individuals because everyone's path is unique. My path is different from yours, but I can help you find your path and I can give you assistance and tools to move you along it. Of course, in the ultimate view, there is no path, there is no teaching, there is no master, there is no God. But that's from the point of realization, and I know you're not there yet. So I'm still talking on the level of positivism, that there is a path, there is a goal, there is a God, there is a realization, and there is some knowledge that will help you. That's the knowledge I want to share with you. So those who are serious about attaining liberation, attaining realization, about getting free from suffering, about solving all the problems of life permanently, check into this teaching. This is not your typical guru trip. I have my own personal issues and flaws, no doubt. I'm perfectly imperfect. And so are you. So the real point is, does this teaching work? Does this method produce results? There's only one way to find out, and that is to watch these videos and understand this process of samadhi in all seven chakras. Namaste. Om Harihi Om.